Turn with me as we turn in our hymnals to our song for the hour. 456 in your hymnals. My country, 'tis of thee. Sweet land of liberty.
Teaching
in the temple. And at that night, he went out and abode in a mountain that is called the Mount of Olives. All the people came early in the morning to him in the temple for to hear him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to all. Father God, we thank you now. We thank you for all of these men who served, gave up their lives so that we may have the freedom we have. Yeah. We are blessed in their presence. And thank you, Lord, for just being so good and so kind and so merciful. Ask now, Lord, that you remove me from me and hide me behind the cross so that your people may hear your word despite of what I may say or do, for your word is far more sufficient than I could ever be. And I pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Always we say, amen. Let's look at the subject, a threefold warning, a threefold warning. Here is a time when Jesus has made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And as you remember, in entering Jerusalem, he cleaned up the temple and entered into several debates with the religious leaders of that day that he repeatedly warned them again and again. Then he praised the poor widows and his offering and pass judgment on the religious leaders. Now Jesus left the temple never to return. Jesus realized now was the time that he would need to tell them the real story of what was about to happen and why. This is also an interesting story that relates to our situation of today. Today we are faced with trying times, and we're with so much uncertainty. We now are to be governed by someone who is often unpredictable. So therefore, we know not what to expect next. We don't know what our future really holds. Even in the day of his election, the stock market went down because of the uncertainty of who he was and what he will do. We are living in a day where even in our own African American communities, we see things are happening now that we never even thought that would happen. Just the other day, an old man was broken into. And who would have ever thought that an old man would be raped in his own home by a young boy? We are seeing things that are quite disgusting.
we find that there are oftentimes we feel that there's no hope. Our hope is maybe questionable to whether even we can make it to the next milestone in our lifetime. Truly enough, all of us have lived in a time that we should treasure for a long time. I used to hear my father and grandfather and elderly people all around when I was coming up wondering, when are we going to have a black president? Well, that day has come and now almost about to pass. But yet we are not even treasuring that. So much uncertainty. So it was at the time of Jesus when he was about to leave the temple for the final time and never to return. So much uncertainty to what was going to happen to him. So much disbelief. But here he began to talk with them. I call this text real talk from a real man. Real talk from a real man. All right. Real talk in the sense that he began to share with them the real truth. And even the truth was not taken the way it should have. Even he knew that there would be some who wouldn't even listen to the truth. We live in such a day where people would rather believe lies than to believe truth. We live in a day where the Bible has come to life in our own time. Here, you tell them that they are going to be faced with wars and commotions. He tells them that nations are going to rise against nations and kingdoms against kingdoms. But still the people had two important questions that they wanted answered. And sometimes we want answers to things that it's sometimes hard to answer. Here they wanted answers because they said, "Master, but when shall these things be?" Not only did they want to know when they were going to be, but they also wanted to know, "And what signs shall we look for?" What signs will there be when these things shall come to pass? Well, we already see. The time is here.
Yes.
And it has now come to pass. We are now transitioning into a new era of life, full of uncertainties, full of doubt and trouble, full of what we don't even know what will happen in the next moment. But yet God constantly gives Jesus a word for us to be comforted. He constantly gives him the word to help us to understand the scripture. In verse 8, he continues to tell us, and he said, "Take heed that ye be not deceived." my name, saying I am Christ. And the time draw near. He said, go ye therefore, and not after them. In other words, the first warning that he gives us is don't be deceived. And as we move into this time of uncertainty, and we move into this unprecedented time of our lives, and we move into this time in the country when they prefer someone who far more unrecognizable as a presidency, we should not be deceived. We should not be deceived to the point where we stop serving God. We should not be deceived to the point where we begin to act like Eve in the Garden of Eden. We should not get to the point where we allow Satan to dispute God's word. Don't let Satan come and let us deny the word of God. Don't let Satan come and displace God's word in our lives. In other words, we now challenge as the church. We are challenged as Christians. We are challenged as people of God to be people of God and be not deceived and allow ourselves to understand it is the Lord who giveth, and it is the Lord who taketh away. Thanks be in the name of the Lord. We need to understand that evil have always surrounded us, and nobody should know it better than the African American. We've never been to the point where we had all the glory. I like it when one man was being interviewed and he was asked, if our president-elect began the war and began to make times tough in America for ones to live in it, he said, what are you going to do? And the man looked at the reporter. He pondered a minute. And he said to the reporter, he said, well, one thing I do know, black folks going to make it. And the reporter was stunned to why he would say such a thing. Say, because we used to eating out of the can. Say, we'd have been there where we had to sleep on the cot. We know what it's like to be at the bottom of the barrel. He said, the ones I'm feeling sorry for are those who never slept on the floor. We're going to make it. Oh, we're not going to be deceived.
That's right.
We're not going to allow anyone to take the word of God from our hearts.
That's right.
From what God had planted it. Secondly, he tells us, but when ye hear of wars and commotion, he said, be not terrified. For these things must first come to pass. But the end is not by and by. He said, nation would go against nations and kingdoms against kingdoms. But his second warning to us, but time now to prepare. It's a time to prepare also to come together like we used to do. It's a time to come and share with one another. It's a time to come and embrace each other. It's a time to come and share what we have so that all can do well. It's a time not to be afraid, but it's a time to prepare, a time to move forward, a time to keep our focus. But we need to make sure our focus is on Jesus. We need to trust him now more than we ever trusted him before. We need to believe where there's never been any belief. We need to know that he is God. There never bomb in Gilead that healed a sin sick soul. Yes, there is. We need to know God is real. We need to know he still lives. We need to know that he rose. Not just for himself, but he rose for our good. We need to know that God is with us. He's there for us. And we need to believe that God promised us that he'll never leave us. He'll never forsake us. He'll never leave us alone. That is our testimony. In verse 13 it says, and it shall turn to you for a testimony. And when that testimony time comes, we ought to be like the elders of old. We ought to stand proud and let it be known to the world that I'm going to make heaven my home. I'm not going to leave the country. I'm going to go home. Don't let yourself be deceived. Don't let yourself become afraid. Because he said, even with that, the end is not by and by. Even with all the trouble around us, it is not the end. When trouble comes around, I find it's my beginning. Because it's my beginning to change. It's my beginning to hold on to his unchanging hand. It's my beginning to know that my God loves me despite of me. It's my beginning to know that I will survive. But it also comes to the point in our lives where we allow so much to distract us. In 34th verse, and it take ye to yourself, lest at any time your heart can be overcharged with surfeitness and drunkenness. In other words, you can become so filthy. You can become so drunk. But the one thing I learned about getting drunk and getting down in the dirt. When you rise, the problems are still there. When you clean up, the problems are still there. When you sober up, the problems are still there. You haven't put anything away. and the other was legalizing marijuana. Not realizing that's just a political game. Because all they want to do is save a little money from putting users in jail. Where they used to put you in jail for paraphernalia. Now they don't want to stop you for paraphernalia. They don't want to have anything to do with that little stuff. If you don't have $10,000 or $15,000 or $100,000 in the trunk of your car, they're going to let you go anyway. Because we become distracted. And not looking at the fact that they know that we'll gravitate towards anything to take away the pain, to hide reality, to shelter ourselves from doing what is right and healthy for our community. And we too do it. We distract people from God with all the filthy mess we do. Even in the church. Amen, walls. We need to become the church that God said he's going to send Jesus back again. To receive him. To receive us into himself. And that's what we should be concentrating on. I loved the song when I was coming up. I just want to be ready when he called my name.
Yes.
Do you want to be ready?
Yes.
Or are you going to be distracted? I want to be ready for when he calls my name. I don't want to have any distractions that will keep me from his glory. I don't want to be where I can see my Jesus and recognize who he is. I don't want to be doped up. I don't need no marijuana high. I'm high already. I'm high on Jesus. Jesus is my high. He's my fountain of glory. He's my fountain of everlasting life. He's my all in all. He's my pillar that holds my head. Oh, I want to be ready when he calls my name. I want my heart to be right. I want my change to come. I want to be able to feast with him at the table.
Yes.
But are you ready? Or are we going to give this earthly man more credit than he deserves? He doesn't even deserve the credit we're giving him. We're giving him too much credit. If we give Jesus the same credit we're giving that process, we'll be far beyond our reach. We need to believe in each other. We need to come to the point in our lives where we can stop putting each other down and begin to lift each other up. We need not be deceived of a few doubting situations. But we need not be afraid of what would happen. We need to be encouraged about what God had already made happen. And therefore, what he had made happen should never distract us. it should never be unknown that God sent his only begotten Son. God so loved the world that he not want us to perish. He not want us to live in a way that he not intended for us to live. He sent his only Son to even clean up our sins. Even though we are filthy rags, not worthy of the dirt that we were made from, he still called us his children. And I still can claim that I am a child of the King. I'm a child of the man who hung on the cross. I'm a child of a man they put in a barn too. I'm a child of a man who rose early that Sunday morning, who lived for my good, who told me, go on, press on, do what God calls you to do. And stop worrying. Stop worrying.
Yes.
We already got our warnings. We already got what we need. We just need to use it. And be patient in the Lord. Be not deceived. Don't be afraid. Don't allow anything to distract you from our Lord and Savior. One thing I do know, Trump didn't save me. I know who saved me. I know who gave me life and gave it to me abundantly. I know who he is. I know the Lord. He heard my cry. I know who he is. He brought me from a mighty long way. He's the lily of the valley. He's my bright and morning star. He is. Because there's no man other than my God.
Come, there may be someone here today
who would love to give that life to Christ.
Your presence is there.
thank you, Lord. Come now, Lord. Forgive us. Father, we all have sinned. We all have fallen short of the coming of that word. We thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for cleansing us, washing us as white as snow. Thank you, Lord, for just being who you are, a forgiving God, a God of a second chance. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Father, please, understanding, Lord, that you have all power in the palm of your hand. We're not worried about the White House. We're not worried about Congress. We're not worried about anything but you, Lord. Lord, don't withdraw your hand from us. Let us hold on to the very end. Let us be the one who you will come back for. Because you have cleaned us up so well. You have made us whole again. Got our minds right. Our hearts right. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Father, we pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray. And always we say, amen. Amen.